so many degrees from its undeformed shape. So, you know, if our goal is to find out, you know, sort of how much rotation this design can handle, then we need to go in here and, you know, I can tell you just from experience that we're probably going way past that failure point, even when we switch over to a more accurate nonlinear analysis that takes in the behavior after yield. So dividing that by 10 down to maybe a 3-degree rotation instead of a 30-degree rotation will give us a little bit better perspective on that, and we can look at it that way as well. So I just changed that first mesh back. To make it consistent. I'm opening up the second mesh here. I'll edit that one, and I'll also divide the prescribed displacement by 10 on that one as well to make that a much smaller displacement. And we'll go ahead and rerun that one. And we get the same error again. For consistency purposes, we'll say no, because that is getting into a low-level nonlinear while using the static tool, and we actually want to account for the stress strain curve, which needs to be accounted for in a nonlinear analysis. This is just our entry level into getting a mesh that we can use for the nonlinear purposes. So as we can see here, it's solving, takes a little bit longer with the denser mesh, but you can see here, even with these elemental and the elements being so small, you can see the nice looking smooth contours you have, which tells me that this is, you know, more likely to be converged than we saw in the previous study. And we do always want, you know, 3 points determines a pattern. So we always do want to make sure we run at least 3 meshes to understand, you know, if we've converged on a solution or not. So here we are setting up our third mesh refinement. And really, the only thing we're going to go and do is refine our mesh control and cut it in half one more time, just to make that mesh extra dense, to make sure that, you know, there are no sorts of changes there that are going to significantly change our maximum stress prediction in that fillet. Now what I'm going to do here is I'm going to go ahead and open up Excel, and I'm going to put together a small little table where I document the 3 different meshes and the maximum stress in the radius relating to those. So what I'm really looking for is that the change in percentage of the maximum stress between meshes becomes really small. When it does, we've reached what we call convergence. And generally what you'll see when you're in convergence, you'll see that you'll get, if you're very coarse, you'll get sort of a value, and as you refine, that value may even drop, and then as you refine more, it goes up and sort of reaches an asymptote. And at some point, you can keep refining and you'll get small fluctuations in value as you're slightly changing the geometry each time. But really what you're looking for is that fluctuation sort of keeps going up and down of maybe 1 or 2% and really doesn't jump anywhere new at all. And that's when we decide to take those values. And, you know, 1 to 2% is generally fine because we are capturing other factors of uncertainty in factors of safety, such as material variances, which might be 5 to 10%, such as geometry tolerances that might be off, all those sorts of factors. So we just did a probe. We got the maximum value in that fillet from probing that by right-clicking on the plot, selecting probe, choosing unselected entities, and choosing the face. And then we click update, and we scroll down to the summary where it tells us the max value. And we take a look at that. We plug that max value into our spreadsheet. And in this case, you can see the first one was 6.39 to the 8th power, and the second one is 8.71 to the 8th power. That's a pretty big difference, like about a third increase of a third. So that's where we, you know, between that first and second mesh, we don't know, you know, if we've gone far enough, because that's a big jump. And that's why the third mesh is necessary to determine if we're still jumping big like that or if we're in the right zone at this point. So as we can see here, this third mesh gives us a value of 8.75, which compared to the previous jump is next to nothing. And in fact, we can use Excel here, calculate a percentage change in the mesh value, in the stress values produced by the change in mesh size. And we'll see what we get here as far as the difference between the two meshes. So I'm going to subtract the two values in stress and then divide by the stress value in the first mesh to see what a percent change is. And I'm just changing the format here to percentage. And then I'm just gonna drag that formula down. So that we can see that in the first mesh refinement, we had a 36% change in stress value, which tells us the problem at that point is highly dependent on the mesh size, which means that the geometry is not well represented yet. But as we refine that significantly in mesh two, then we can see that we only have about a 0.5% change in result. So we've converged. So that is convergence analysis in SOLIDWORKS Simulation. If you're using other simulation tools, it's possible that the methods are different, but the concept is the same. Applying different mesh controls in different ways in those softwares as well will also be beneficial. And pulling out the results and making sure they're independent of the mesh is very important. If you ever have any questions at all, GSC is a resource for finite element analysis, and I am in particular a person that you can reach out to. I've put my information up here on the screen, and you can always reach out at any time. And if there's ever anything that we can do to teach you more about these topics, let me know. I'm here to help, and I look forward to seeing you on the next video. Thank you. Bye.